Okay, let me.
Well, good day, everyone. Welcome to today's AIAA Los Angeles Las Vegas section event. It's a hybrid event today. My name is Jeff Puchel. I'm the moderator for this event. I'm joining you from my home office in the San Ynez Valley of Santa Barbara County, California. Our speaker today is joining us from France, so this is a truly distributed architecture. Our speaker is Dr. Dominique Valentien, who's going to talk about a long-duration lander concept for Venus. Now, in my view, Venus is a planet that we don't pay enough attention to. It's really the closest planet to the Earth, and in some ways, most like Earth. But as you'll hear today, it's also distinctly different from the Earth. So Dr. Valentien is AIAA Associate Fellow. He's also a member of the AIAA Electric Propulsion Technical Committee. He is really working today as a consultant. I'm gathering, Dominique, that you probably retired in 2007 and became a consultant after that. So
Absolutely.
yes, yeah. So I hope you're having a good time as a consultant. Among other things, Dominique has written a book in French, though, on the world of rocket propulsion, which I've heard very good things about. That was published in April of 2015, and I'm sure that would be worth taking a look at. Well, without further ado, let me conclude this introduction and ask you, Dominique, to begin your presentation.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will go to next slide. This is a table of content. So my study is starting from an earlier work made 4 years ago on a very complex mission. This is Venus sample return. From this concept, I issued a very advanced concept for thermal insulation of the Venus lander. I will reuse this principle on this study. It is very important also for a long duration on Venus to remind the Venus characteristics, especially the day and night duration and the visibility from a given point of Venus surface with respect to Earth. Next point is scientific objectives. As you may know, some of them are obvious. We will to observe the modification of Venus atmosphere in concerning the day and night situation, and also the possible modification of the atmosphere due to volcanic activities. Volcanic activities is not proven for the moment, but it is highly suspected. I am not the only guy to consider long life surface lander on Venus, and I will present two earlier works, one from NASA and the other one from European Space Agency. These two long life surface lander are uncooled. What I am proposing is to have a partial cooling of the lander electronics in order to be able to benefit from advanced digital circuitry. So it is necessary to devise an active thermal control of the lander. And you will see this is not that simple because we have extremely narrow margin to ensure this thermal control, even if we are using vacuum thermal insulation to decrease the thermal losses from the Venus environment. This will lead us to Venus lander architecture. Trying to make this as simple as possible. And spewed on interplanetary trajectory, which is quite simple, but the end of the trajectory is more subtle that to have a relatively gentle re-entry, it will be necessary to start the re-entry from a circular low orbit, circular orbit about, around Venus. I will, in the discussion, show that it is highly necessary to use a relay satellite, and I will make a short description of the satellite. So then the conclusion on a few words after that. Next slide, please. The exploration of Venus is known as a very difficult problem because the ground level temperature is around 460 degrees Celsius. This is probably close to more than 700 to 800 Fahrenheit, and 9.2 megapascal. That is 92 atmosphere, if you prefer. For the moment, at my knowledge, the longest duration measurement of Venus surface is around 1 hour. Approximately shared between the last Venera model from Soviet Union and a NASA probe. This short time frame is short time frame is sufficient to perform sample recovery. I will discuss this after, but this is quite difficult. Paradoxically, a long-term surface mission may be more simpler than the sample return mission. Concerning the scientific objective, the mission duration should be at least one Venusian year. That is 2 Venusian days. That is 2 cycle night day. And preferably longer, 1 terrestrial year. But it should be understood that this mission is extremely difficult anyway. Next slide, please. Venus sample return. I have proposed this almost 4 years ago in the frame of an ESA conference called Voyage 2050. The frame of this conference was to devise new scientific mission for the time frame 2035 to 2050. This proposal was quite complex. This study has been made before by a jet propulsion laboratory with a single launcher, and this was extremely difficult to handle everything in a single payload. So I elected to relax the difficulty by using 3 launchers. This enabled to use 3 quadcopter landers because the single point failure is a lander. So if you have 3 landers, you have a small chance to recover at least 1 sample. An orbiter, which is designed to return the sample to Earth, and a very complex device also, a balloon holding a 3-stages micro launcher, returning the sample provided by the quadcopter to the orbiter. To give you an idea of the size of the device, from I worked years ago on a 3-stage micro launcher launched from an airplane with a payload of 60 kilograms in Sun Synchronous orbit. So I know that on Earth with 7 tons, you can have something possible. In that case, this is a 4-ton micro launcher. So to hold 4 tons at 55 km altitude at Venus, you need 4,000 cubic meters balloon, which is quite a big one. And in addition, it was necessary to use really micro satellites to provide links between the balloons, the launcher, and the orbiter. Next slide, please. This is an image. The mission needs three Ariane 6 launchers. The fairing is almost identical to the one of Ariane 5. So you can see the dimension almost 20 meters in height, 5.2 meters in diameter, and dynamic maximum diameter for the payload of 4.7 meters. I will not insist on this. You see the balloon rocket assembly on left, the interplanetary module with the three landers in the middle, and the sample return orbiter at right. Next slide, please. The heart of the mission is the UAV lander. The idea is to use a quadcopter supplied by lithium-ion batteries and including phase change material to provide the cooling. The idea is to take off vertically from the Venus surface and also to land vertically with the quadcopter, because the interest is that you can make a soft landing by this way. After sample collection, which is probably with a diamond tool, it will take off and operate as a plane to make a rendezvous with the balloon. The difficulty, as you can imagine, is to have the resistance. The body will be put under vacuum, and it is necessary to provide protection against local buckling, because under the very high pressure provided by Venus atmosphere, you will risk the buckling of the structure. Next slide, please. This shows the internal part of the quadcopter. The idea is to use a buckling resistant structure, which is titanium forging integrally machined with a second shell. So the two shells bonded together provide a resistance to local buckling with a minimum payload risk. The isolation is made by polar studs, and the payload is contained in a spherical sphere, which is super insulated. In the past, we have developed space furnaces, and we have made measurement of super insulation thermal conductivity. It is extremely low, with around 10 minus 5 watts per square centimeter on Kelvin. This means that for a 50 centimeter diameter payload, you have a radiative thermal flux which is limited to 26 watts. And the polar stud losses are limited to 25 watts. That is, you will require a cooling power of 50 watts only with this vacuum insulation concept. Next slide, please. The study was not pursued because, as you can imagine, using three Ariane 6 launch, or if you take the US launcher case, three Atlas V launches, plus the development of each spacecraft, you are going to a total sum of 2 to 3 billion dollars. Despite the interest of recovering Venus sample, this is obviously too costly, And we have to reorient the work to a long life lander concept. Next slide, please. Some words on Venus characteristics. Perinusian year duration is 224 Earth days, and the Venus sidereal days is retrograde. If we speak of Venus solar days, which is interesting for us, this is 116 Earth days. That is, each Venusian day on each night has a duration of 58 days on some hours. Another interesting point, not to be neglected. If you look at synodic periods, that is, the Venus and Earth mutual location, this occurs every 583 Earth days, which is 5 Venusian days. And this shows, as you can imagine, that it is not possible to maintain the direct link between Venusian point of the Venusian surface on Earth during several months. We could do that for 1 month or something like that. And the conclusion is you need a relay satellite. Next slide, please. Speaking of scientific objective, as I saw already, the first point on obvious is seismology. This, you have two impacts, that is, to know the potential seism on Venus structure, and to detect volcano eruption. Another point, we don't know anything about that, is the ground level atmospheric composition and its composition variation. If you have volcanic eruption, you can imagine that the atmosphere composition will be slightly modified, as it has been on Earth. And you can also expect seasonal composition change in between night and day. Of course, the ground pressure and temperature will be measured. This is almost evident. And we will see also that it will be interesting to measure wind speed and direction. Wind is expected to be in the range of 1 meter per second. Local soil composition is perhaps less interesting. Excuse me. And imagine on the other side could be very interesting. Comparing the day images of the cloud cover and during night, possible thunderstorm flashes or glow during Venusian night. Some people think there is a glow on the cloud cover. And last point, but it is one of the most complicated situation, is the nephelometer in order to detect volcanic plumes. Next slide, please. The translation of scientific objective on instrumentation. Seismology, this has been proposed by other authors. High temperature MMS seismometer could be a relatively simple method. In that case, seismometer is working at Venus temperature, that is 460 Celsius. Ground level atmospheric composition, if you want to make something extremely thin, you will need a sampling valve to have a few cubic millimeter TPN of Venusian atmosphere, followed by a gas chromatograph mass spectrometer, which has been developed by NASA for Cassini-Huygens probe. This needs a vacuum pump, like a turbomolecular pump, a small one, and vacuum reserve. This is fairly complex system, I must say. It is much simpler to have an MMS sensor, but this will not give you the same sensibility nor the same resolution. Concerning wind speed and direction, an ultrasonic wind sensor could be a very simple solution. Concerning imaging, we don't need to use MOVI. Still images will be sufficient. So a scanning mirror, an optical fiber bundle, and a CMOS sensor at ambient temperature will do the job. Nephelometer is much more complicated because you need a laser to measure the backscatter light, an optical fiber bundle to have an imager system. Next slide, please. I have noted two earlier works on long-life surface lander. One is LISS from NASA, and the other one is VL2SP, Oxford University, on the sponsorship of European Space Agency, of course. Next slide, please. LISS, you see the image on the right, is shown here with a vertical axis wind turbine. The baseline of the platform is supplied by a chemical battery operating at high temperature. And in the case of battery, the life is estimated to 60 days, which is a lot already. The electronics is uncooled and relies on silicon carbide electronics. Silicon carbide electronics are well developed for automotive industry, electrical cars, and it has shown the possibility to work at almost 500 Celsius. Of course, the rest of electronics is quite complicated. In that case, the transmission power is fairly low, so the authors propose to use a relay satellite orbiting at 70,000 kilometers. As you can imagine, the problem will be not the power electronics, but the measurement on digital electronics. This will be the difficulty. Next slide, please. This is a European proposal. You see the seismometer, which is the main payload. And in that case, it is supplied by an RTG because the author wants to have a measurement of at least 3 months, 100 days, because we don't know what is the frequency of seismic event on Venus. This has been proposed by Professor Colin Wilson, which is a specialist of Venus exploration. The RTG is supposed to provide 25 watts of power for a mass of 24 kilo. You will see that in my study, I propose a much more powerful RTG. Next slide, please. The high temperature electronics is feasible because some laboratories in Europe or in United States succeeded in operating silicon carbide electronics at 500 Celsius. But the difficulty is that in the field of large-scale integration components. And we need onboard computer, memories, etc. So the idea is to split the electronic in two parts. High temperature electronics for everything that is power electronics. For the radio transmission, It is possible to use vacuum tube electronics, like traveling wave tube, which will support 400 Celsius without problem. And a classical cooled electronics for all digital function on CMOS for the camera. Next slide, please. We need a power source to perform active cooling and, of course, to operate the payload. We have two possibilities. RTG, in that case, this is something very similar to next-gen RTG used in the United States, or a wind turbine, as proposed in the US LIS project. Next slide, please. Concerning the RTG, we start the study from the RTG embark on New Horizon. That is 4 kilowatt thermal power. And in the case of New Horizon, almost 300 watt electrical power. The project after that is next-gen model 2. Which will provide 400 watts of electrical power for a mass of 55 kilograms. The problem is that the RTG is designed to operate under vacuum and with 4K, 3K vacuum temperature. In that case, we will need to benefit from the vacuum insulation to have the required power. So it will be necessary to house the next-gen model 2 in a cylindrical pressure shell, made preferably of nickel alloy because the heat conduction will be fairly good. And of course, it will be necessary to have a lot of fin to ensure the convection cooling of the RTG. Of course, this will add in between 45 and 40 kilograms of supplementary mass. Power decay is not a problem because the mission duration is 1 year. It will be difficult to go beyond that. The source of the RTG, the most obvious is obvious Department of Energy, but this will require a launch from the from USA. We have discussion to build RTG in Europe because European companies have a stock of neptunium resulting from the processing of nuclear fuel, and it will be possible to convert this to plutonium-238 by using a neutron spallation source. There is a very powerful neutron spallation source, which is a building in Sweden. Next slide, please. Concerning the wind turbine, I made personal studies on this question in the design of a Venusian rover. This is an extremely ambitious mission too. The big unknown, and unfortunately, the wind speed variation, excuse me, on the Venus surface. The wind turbine power is proportional to the third power of wind speed. This is the problem. Excuse me. Assuming a cruise speed of 1 meter per second, 5 meter rotor is necessary to provide a power in excess of 300 watts. Power we need to operate the active cooling. Next slide, please. It is possible, however, to house a 5 meter diameter rotor in an aeroshell diameter of 4 meters using a system similar to the folding of a helicopter rotor. But you will see that this is a fairly complicated layout, and so due to the known, the baseline of the study is RTG. Next slide, please. Concerning power source, we need also an energy storage. This is not the case of most distant planet probes, because the energy budget doesn't need this. But in the case of this mission, we will need to have a power surge, like for radio transmission or laser nephelometer. We can't forget about the lithium accumulator, because the temperature will not be even near ambient temperature. The lithium accumulator is a too risky technology, so we will be obliged to use heavier device like a magnetic bearing flywheel, which work very well, or supercapacitors. Next slide, please. Concerning the active thermal control, the active cooling of cryogenic facility is well known in space. We have three main technologies: Stirling refrigerator, which offers the best efficiency, and we will need high efficiency because the power budget is quite limited; pulse tube refrigerator, which offers the best reliability, which is very high use in Europe; reverse turbo Brayton refrigerator, which offer a very low vibration level, but the minimum power of reverse turbo Brayton is something like 500 watts to 1 kilowatt. All the systems are used in space for cryogenic cooling, from 300K to 80K or lower. The idea is to translate the temperature range to 460 Celsius to that is 700 Kelvin to 300 Kelvin. But the physical principle is the same. Next slide, please. The principle of Stirling refrigerator. You have a compressor using opposite piston, frictionless. They are mounted on flat springs. The reliability of this device is extremely high. The experience is in excess of 10 years, unlimited operation. After the heat generated by the compression is rejected by generally a conductive heat exchanger, and the main part of the system is the regenerator. This is the heart of the system efficiency. So you have the cold finger and a free piston. So the cold gas issued from the regenerator displays the free piston, and the cooled gas will cooling new times the regenerator, which enable to cool the gas coming from the opposite piston compressor. The gas is generally helium. Next slide, please. This is an example. This is not a Stirling refrigerator, this is a pulse tube, but the general layout is the same. You see at right the opposite piston system, and at left the cooling finger. In that case, the cooling power is 3 watts at 50K for 180 80 watt, 20 watt, excuse me, electrical power on overall mass of 7 kilo. This system is already flown on Meteosat third generation, and it is performing flawlessly. Next slide, please. We have to discuss the efficiency of the system. Actually, the best Stirling refrigerator provides an efficiency which is around 30% of Carnot efficiency. So if we make a small table, the hot temperature is 750K. The cold temperature is varied for the purpose of the study from 270K, that is 3 Celsius below the ice temperature. And I made a study up to 90 Celsius. Obviously, 270K is enabling the use of ice as a phase change material. This is extremely interesting at a power accumulator. But unfortunately, as you can see, the cooling power is too small. It is much better to use higher temperature, which enable to have a power around 75 watts. That is 25 excess power to operate the electronics. Sodium could be also a very interesting possibility, but the temperature is quite too high at 353K. We are at around 60 degrees Celsius, which is quite tolerable for space electronics. Next slide, please. So we are rejecting the case of ice. This is unfortunate because ice is very efficient. And sodium or potassium phase change material are on order of magnitude less efficient, but this will be interesting to accommodate payload power variation. The Stirling compressor has only one small disturbing effect, that is, it provides vibration in the frequency range of 30 to 50 Hertz. So it is absolutely necessary to decouple the seismometer from the payload structure. Next slide, please. So we will simplify the architecture with respect to the quadcopter you saw at the beginning. We have no very stringent weight limitation, so we can use a cylindrical pressure shell. This is like the shell of a submarine operating at 1,000 meters depth on Earth. Super insulation will be also much simpler because it is very easy to make a super insulation form of a cylindrical wall on a flat plate and a simple neck made of a very thin titanium tube will support the payload on the super insulation. So the system is fairly simple, and all electrical and optical feed through will be located at the top of the payload pressure shell. Next slide, please. This shows how to integrate the cooler on the super insulation and neck device. The regenerator part of the cooler will be located in the neck. So the temperature gradient is ensured by this way. The compressor and the electronics are outside the pressure shell submitted to Venus atmosphere. The cold finger from the refrigerator will also cool the phase change material. And at Venus, we have the benefit of natural convection provided to the atmosphere in the payload compartment. And this will be simplify the thermal control. Obviously, the linear motor used in present day compressor are limited to 100 Celsius, something like that. Fortunately, for all effect thruster development, we have developed, or US company have developed, electromagnetic technology, which are compatible with a temperature of 400 to 500 Celsius. So this will be a reuse of this existing technology. Next slide, please. This shows a potential lander architecture. On the right, you have the pressure shell protecting the payload, with the steering refrigerator hot part on top, and on top of it, an antenna very similar to the antennas used on Venera lander, which is almost omnidirectional antenna. And the RTG is located at the opposite side to avoid to hit the payload. And the annular base will provide a diameter of around 2 meters. You see strings which are necessary to rigidify the system. Next slide, please. This is a top view of the proposed device. The aeroshell diameter will be in between 3 and 4 meters. The annular ring diameter is 2 meters. You see the RTG on one side, the payload on the other, and the parachute will be located in the middle. Probably below the parachute, you will have the seismometer also. Next slide, please. Interplanetary trajectory. The beginning of the trajectory will be relatively simple. Oman transfer in between Earth and Venus. And this is very similar to the Venus European Space Agency Venus orbiter. That is a chemical burn with the propulsion module will provide a delta V of 1.2 kilometers per second. So you are located in a very highly elliptical orbit. The energy of this orbit is too high to have a gentle re-entry. So during 1 year, you will reduce the electrical orbit to low circular orbit by a combination of aerobraking. This has been made on another mission, either in the United States or in Europe, and electric propulsion, because you need to raise a little bit the periapsis. Why this procedure? This is to decrease the severity of peak acceleration to around 6G. And this enabled to have a very efficient thermal insulation of the cooled system. To perform the re-entry, the propulsion module, which has been used to provide the first delta V, will perform the re-entry burn, 150 meters per second, and the orbiter will be destroyed in Venus atmosphere. Next slide, please. We have discussed on the relay satellite. This will be a micro satellite around less than 100 kilograms. with a large parabolic antenna pointed toward Earth, and another wide aperture antenna pointed toward Venus surface. The orbit will be elliptical, with an apoapsis facing the lander. That is, the apoapsis altitude will be discussed after an analysis of the transmission power from the lander. And the apoapsis has the interest to increase the transmission time between the lander and the orbiter. It may be necessary to use electric propulsion to have on a lower apoapsis, lower than 60,000 kilometers, and higher periapsis to avoid atmospheric drag. Question is communication toward between Earth and Venus, because it may be possible to avoid to have communication when Venus is located behind Sun. Because if we are placing the mission within range of Venus-Earth synodic period, we will have at least one Venusian year to have transmission without major problem. But anyway, it is more prudent to provide the satellite with the possibility of storing several weeks of data. Okay. Next slide, please. So I will return on the conclusion of the Venus sample return, because we were confused that the cost will be very high. So the idea was to have an extended life lander. This was written 4 years ago, and combined the Atmos thermal insulation with Stirling cooler. It was proposed a pulse tube, but Stirling has a higher efficiency. RTG fed. The study shows that it is feasible and much less costly than the sample return mission. And if you are looking at the ongoing studies in USA and in Europe, even if the mission is less ambitious than this one, the first long life lander will probably become a reality in a not so distant future. Next slide, please. Thank you for your attention. And you see an image of Venus with Jupiter and Earth in the background.
Thank you very much, Dominique. Excellent talk, fascinating talk. So we have time for questions, and I'm going to take the prerogative of the chair by asking the first question.
Yes.
You know, in some of our long-range mission thinking here in the U.S., you know, we're looking at the possibility of using the Starship from SpaceX as a launch vehicle. And of course, it's still in development. Some claims have been made of how much it would cost to launch payloads into space using that launch vehicle. I'm wondering whether you think Starship might offer a low enough cost to enable the sample return mission from a financial point of view.
Ah. Obviously, in the case of Starship, the payload is extremely important. And even we can discuss more or less freely on this idea, even if Starship is used only in low Earth orbit, you can launch around 100 tons from Starship. So you have all the mass necessary to provide even storyboard propellant upper stage to launch the whole vehicle to Venus, to insert it in Venus orbit, and so you will end up with all the device necessary in a low circular Venus orbit, which is equatorial in that case. So it is extremely interesting from the technical point of view.
All right, thank you very much. Yes, well, we'll look forward to seeing how Starship turns out and how economical it actually turns out to be for launching large payloads. I think it's very promising, but we'll see what happens. So I see we have one question in the Q&A from AC, and that question is, low transmitter power is milliwatts or microwatts, I think is what AC is asking.
I think that the transmitting power is in the range of several watts.
Yes.
From I understood from the European Space Agency study.
Okay, we have another question here in the Q&A from an anonymous attendee, and I think we have more people attending virtually, but I'll switch back to the on-site attendees in just a moment. So the anonymous attendee wants to know, how predictable are the Venusian winds, and how does this impact the probability of success for a sample return mission?
In the GPL study or in my study, it was clear that the only possibility was to start from an equatorial orbit. Equatorial location for the sample drilling, because this is the only way in the Venusian atmosphere where you can be pretty sure that the winds are located in one direction. If you are not in equatorial orbit, you will never be successful in making a rendezvous with the balloon.
Interesting. Very interesting. Let me switch to the chat. Okay, so yes, Ken sent a message just saying, raise your hand on Zoom to get the mic access to speak out your question. And I think he sent it twice, basically. So yes, that would be helpful. And let me switch my mode. Okay, so AC had his hand up. Did you
yes.
have another question, AC? Go ahead.
Yes, I did, actually. Thank you very much. That was a very interesting presentation. I have basically two questions. Number one, by the use of RTGs, due to the challenges of the high ambient temperatures, and since RTGs, as I understand, utilize thermoelectric type generators to generate the electricity, will the diminished temperature differential reduce the efficiency of the RTGs and their ability to provide electrical power? And then the second aspect of a question, again, regarding the ambient high temperatures, using wind turbines to perhaps generate also electricity, I assume that's their purpose. And I assume that it would use, for example, permanent magnets in the electrical generation. Would yes. are magnets available with high enough Curie points that would retain their magnetism to be able to utilize in the generators? Thank you.
Okay. Concerning the electrical generator of the wind turbine, this is true that there is a problem with permanent magnets, because permanent magnets will be a very simple solution. For electric propulsion, it was possible to develop samarium cobalt permanent magnet operating much beyond 250 Celsius, which is normally the limit of this technology. But there is still some Celsius missing to reach 460. So in that case, it will be necessary to rely on older magnet technology, which is limited to 400, 500 Celsius. Concerning the ferromagnetic material of the motor, the situation is much easier because we can use iron cobalt alloy, which have a very high Curie temperature, which is 980 Celsius, something like that. So this is why we are using these materials for the magnetic circuit of old effect thruster.
All right, thank you very much. Did that answer your question, AC?
Yes, it did. Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Okay. So, Ken, do we have any questions in the conference room?
Yeah, we do. We do.
Okay.
Figured I might as well comment, like, but this is perfect. First question was are there higher operating temperature options that could be activated once on the surface that would require a lower amount of active cooling measures that are like due to a lower delta T for temperature, and that really aren't considered for most space missions today?
There is practically no application of high temperature except for propulsion, of course. But we have no practically cases of high temperature scientific instrumentation in a space mission. This is a problem. So the only case where you have a scientific instrumentation adapted for high temperature is the case of oil well drilling. You need electronic component working at 250 something Celsius.
Sorry, what was that last term? I heard the temperature, but what was the for what application?
The big problem, as you have understood, is the electronics itself. So we have. It is possible to develop power electronics from this range of power, but the difficulty is with integrated circuitry, because practically all circuitry are engraved from silicone, and silicone is quite limited in temperature. And for the moment, there is no silicon carbide RF devices, for example.
Okay, that's one question. I don't want to block anyone else here, but I have two more questions, actually. We'll say two and a half more questions.
Oh, go ahead. As long as you've got the mic, yes. Just keep going.
Okay, I just invented this question that I didn't write down, but based on that last discussion, are there any possibilities, and I know that this is internationally fraught at this point, but the Russians have a large amount of experience with their landers that they did in the 1970s on Venus. Is there any potential for scientific collaboration or cooperation on that front to leverage the things that they learned in their successful or partially successful missions that occurred from 1972 through the later 70s?
As far as I understood, the Venus Venera lander technology was a pressure shell, conventional one, and no advanced thermal insulation for the payload, and this was limiting the life of the device to 1 hour or something like that. This is not to neglect the knowledge of Russian scientists. They are very good. This is, let me separate the technical discussion from the political one.
Fair,
for
fair
the moment, it is difficult to have a relationship with the Russian people, but on paper, they are extremely interesting.
A couple unrelated question to that discussion. So is, you're kind of on the topic of the relay satellites that was that were discussed, the microsat. Is there two questions I had about that and the two and a half follow-up to that. And a follow-up to that. With the relay satellite that was discussed earlier, is that, was, I wasn't clear, was that the orbiter being kind of repurposed at Venus while in orbit, and then its orbit changed to actually become a relay satellite? Or was that something that would be deployed from the orbiter, or was it something that was basically sent to Venus separately? And then regardless of which of those mechanisms, is that something that would be robust enough to support other missions?
The idea is effectively to deploy the microsatellite from the orbiter. This will be a passenger of the orbiter. This is the interest of having an initial elliptical orbit. And this, the orbiter, I have not discussed this in the presentation, but it may be interesting to have a landing point, which is at some latitude of Venus, in downstream of a suspected volcanic region. In that case, the orbit, initial orbit, will be inclined, but the interest of leaving the relay from the orbiter is that the relay satellite orbital plane will contain the location of the lander, if you see what I mean.
I think a related question I had about the satellites, or maybe this was already determined from the trade, essentially the trade study that was done.
Yes.
Is it, was it, would it not be possible, or I guess the better question, would it be possible to have like two or three microsatellites that would be deployed from the orbiter to ensure, you know, coverage without interruption?
Yes. The interest of two or three microsatellites is that you have a permanent coverage of the landing point. That's clear. My idea was that bearing in mind the scientific mission, it was possible to operate with a single microsatellite, operating only in the visibility period above the lander. This obviously meant that the lander had to have an internal memory to store the data before satellite transmission. And this is the interest of cooling the payload to have the possibility to have a large memory. In the uncooled lander I described before, the electronic scarcity means that you can't make onboard storage at, on the lander. You are obliged to communicate everything that is occurring.
One follow-up with COM and one follow-up with the lander. So on the communications, I don't think this was discussed, and I apologize if I missed it in the presentation. Are there any concerns about the challenges of doing of transmitting the data? The uplink. Sorry, the uplink from the lander to the payload based on atmospheric particulate.
I have not discussed in depth this point, but you can imagine that the microsatellite is sending a request to the lander, and in that case, the lander will send back its telemetry to the relay satellite.
Continue.
This seems to me the simplest way.
Final question, unless it brings up another.
I was going to say, I think you said that before.
I know, this is the last one.
Okay, keep going.
Has there ever been any consideration for these lander missions that there would be that instead of having them exposed to the surface, is there any advantage to actually like putting them subsurface? Is there any way to do that? And would that actually provide any thermal insulation benefits that you would then get in situ versus bringing them along?
To be frank, I have no idea on this question.
Okay. All right. Thank you for all the very interesting questions. Ken, do we have any other questions in the room?
Mr. Kerr has a question here.
Okay.
Thank you. Much of my career has been in scientific research, and so that tells me how naive I am with respect to everything you're talking about. But the number you quoted for expected wind speed is just stretching my imagination. I'm having an awful hard time imagining if you have those wind speeds, if that's accurate, and you have wind speeds like that, and you have turbulence in the atmosphere, it's hard for me to imagine controlled flight under those circumstances, and it's hard for me to imagine, depending on how much you know about the surface, something sitting on the surface without being very, very carefully anchored and being able to stay in one spot. So my imagination is just struggling with that.
I could propose, we are returning to the question of sample return, because your questions are both related to that. This will need a precursor mission. The first point you are stressing is that we don't know how to drill recover a sample from Venus soil. To do that, bearing in mind the quadcopter technology, we could use the simple precursor mission with only a driller, without any ID to recover the sample. But we can use one or two drill technology on the lander and look at what happens before launching the sample recovering mission. Concerning the wind and atmosphere turbulence, this is true. We don't know, we could assume that the turbulence is almost zero at near the surface, because the density of the atmosphere is around 60 kilograms per cubic meter, and the speed is relatively low. So this is not the most difficult part of the mission. The difficulty will be at 50-55 kilometer altitude, and this could be analyzed, and there is some, at least in the United States, some mission proposal to have a balloon with variable altitude. So from the balloon telemetry, you can analyze which is the severity of the turbulence and the turbulence layout.
Okay.
Are you referring to the BAMP, Northrop Grumman BAMP project?
As I said, we are no longer pursuing the sample return mission, so I have not studied this point in detail.
No, I mean the Venus atmosphere maneuverable platform. It's a Northrop Grumman air vehicle project, air shellless hypersonic entry vehicle. It is flying on the top of atmosphere.
Ah. Okay. In my personal opinion, concerning the reentry, we have a problem quite similar to the Mars atmosphere. This is an atmosphere almost completely formed of carbon dioxide. So in the hypersonic regime, you will have the same physics, more or less.
Very good. So any other questions from the room? I don't see any others online. Oh, AC has his hand up again. Go ahead, AC.
Yes, thank you. I know this is perhaps really untenable, but if there are any active volcanic lava flows that are identified, would it be possible to use those temperature gradients to perhaps generate power for a surface lander? Since I assume the actual lava itself would be at a higher temperature than the atmospheric temperature. Thank you.
Okay. Supposing that we can identify not a lava flow, but a very high point of geothermal activities that it exists on Earth, it will be probably possible to devise a small thermodynamic machine operating from the very hot soil on the atmosphere. The difficulty will be to identify in advance the location of the high temperature region on the volcano. But if it is possible to perform a sounding of through the atmosphere with microwave, for example, it may be possible to identify such region.
So on a mission, could possibly something a recapitulation of I believe like the Magellan orbiter that did the surface radar topographic identification of, and I believe even from that data now there seems to be regions that appear to have had lava flows during that mission. So maybe perhaps the orbiter would be able to incorporate a preliminary sort of surface radar type of survey to identify active volcanic regions, something along those lines.
Yes, it is probably fairly easy to use Magellan images and to compare them to a new radar mission. The comparison between both images will show the region where lava flow have occurred in the past, in the very, very recent past, I must say.
Very good. I have a few questions as well, so let me ask those questions quickly. You didn't really indicate how much data you're trying to transmit back to Earth. I don't know what the volume of data would be, but I'm wondering in your trade studies whether you considered the possibility of using LaserCom on the relay satellite. I could see advantages, of course, in terms of data rate, probably in power as well, but also huge challenges related to line of sight stability back to Earth. Did you consider that in your study?
To be frank, no. I have another study ongoing on a very distant mission toward to go outside the solar system limits. In that case, it could be interesting to use a laser transmission to another satellite. We will gain a factor of 5 in transmission bandwidth with respect to a radio frequency system. But in this case, the actual technology will allow to perform a transmission from a microsatellite to Earth, or more exactly, probably to Earth satellite. Because if you are operating, receiving the message with a ground telescope, you are limited by the Earth rotation and by the cloud cover. So it is more interesting, to use a relay satellite in geostationary orbit, for example. But it is not excluded, but due to the approximative data rate necessary for the mission, it could be made with RF-Link, classical RF-Link.
Yeah, I think I agree with your assessment there. And I would also agree that if you don't need laser comm, you should probably stay with RF comm. Another question relates to the aero braking of 300 kilometer altitude for the periapsis. I assume that number was selected based on measurements of the Venusian atmosphere made by previous scientific probes. That seems rather high for aero braking, but then the atmosphere of Venus is quite different from Earth, certainly, and I wouldn't be surprised if it has significant density up to that altitude.
To be more precise, the 300 over 60,100 orbit is a starting stable orbit. As you know, probably, to perform aerobraking, you are activating the chemical thruster on apoapsis to decrease progressively the periapsis. And this is the altitude could be in the range 150 to 165 kilometers. And you have to be very careful when you are doing that, because you can end up with an accidental reentry.
Yes. Well, thanks for the clarification. I would imagine that altitude that you would want could vary according to the solar cycle, for example. And so it's something you'd want to measure in situ, I would think.
Yes, this is why the aerobraking must be performed in a very careful manner.
Yes. Thank you for the clarification. Do we have any other questions, either online or in the room? Well, thank you, Dominique, for joining us today. Your talk was fascinating, and I'm sure all of us appreciate all the time you took to respond to our many questions. Perhaps we'll meet in person someday, either way, all the best to you as you continue these very interesting studies. Let's thank our speaker again.
Thank you.